They're wild and they're free. The many exotic creatures that roam much of Africa. Their daily ritual is aimed at just one result, survival. And yet the very survival of entire species is increasingly in danger. Territory shrinking as an exploding human population competes for land. Consider this. At the start of the 20th century, the major species roamed most of Africa, with the exception of the Sahara and the jungles. 100 years on, their territory has contracted dramatically. It's in this context the daily law of the jungle fight for survival for individual creatures and the new fight for survival for entire species that we set out to experience the majesty of Africa's superb wildlife. It is truly a spectacle of awesome proportions, the annual migration of the wildebeest. Of all the animals in Africa, this rather ungainly herbivore is a clear winner in terms of survival, at least in eastern Africa. Just 40 years ago, the first accurate wildlife census here in Tanzania's Serengeti National Park counted only 100,000 wildebeest. Annual aerial checks these days in the same territory show this migratory population numbers almost 1.5 million. It's an explosion that can be attributed to both an absence of any major epidemic and the zeal with which Tanzania and neighboring Kenya have zoned vast tracts of land for wildlife reserves. But while these common blue wildebeest have survived, their cousin, the white-tailed wildebeest, are now extinct in the wild because white settlers slaughter them for their tails. Even these wildebeest encounter their own slaughter, their vast numbers presenting an easy target for many predators. At the sporadic waterholes and rivers they must cross or quench their thirst at, there waits their deadliest enemy. Crocodiles of eastern Africa are both exceptionally large and strike with surprising stealth. When they do strike, it's with tremendous ferocity. In this attack, two crocodiles clamp their powerful jaws on the unsuspecting victim, then roll in different directions. Is quickly ripped to pieces to be devoured limb by limb. Wildebeest after wildebeest will meet their fate this gruesome way. Many victims are killed this day. They're pushed away to a quieter stretch of water where they'll be eaten later. Another predator attracted by the mass migration is the lion. So confident is this female, she stalks alone, in broad daylight. A brief chase sparks a stampede, but not before she claims one victim. There follows a ritual to ensure the animal is well and truly dead. Before the feast begins, the lion will drag her very heavy kill to a secluded, shady spot. Not every lion chase results in victory. This youngster has been separated from the herd and actually walks towards a pride of waiting lions. It all looks so easy. One of the lionesses breaks from her midday slumber to stalk what should be a relatively effortless meal. And the chase is on. But in less than 30 meters, the smaller of the two is simply faster and more motivated. Also traveling in the mass migration is the Burchell zebra. Outnumbered 6-1 by the wildebeest, they've found safety in numbers by joining them on the 800 kilometer trek each year to and from Kenya's Masai Mara. There's much intimacy in the herds of zebras. Courtship between a stallion and filly. And babies suckling. As these large concentrations quickly exhaust grazing grounds and move on for greener pastures, they're keenly watched by another creature of the plains. The Maasai giraffe is also under threat from the many predators attracted by the migration. But their food supply at least is safe, as they graze almost exclusively on the tender leaves of the acacia tree. They're a marvel of adaptation, their long legs and neck allowing them access to a food supply out of reach to all other herbivores. And because they don't compete for food, they're able to share their habitat with a wide range of creatures. Here in the Serengeti, there's still 8,000 of them. But in many other parts of the continent, they've been eliminated. Where once they roamed widely, they've now disappeared from much of Western Africa and the southern Kalahari, surviving only in far fewer and isolated territories. As darkness descends across Africa, the giraffe faces a very real threat from his major adversary, the lion. This young pride will hunt when full darkness has set in. Before the serious business of hunting begins, there's ample time to play. Innocent as it appears, such play both toughens their muscles and strengthens the bonds between one another. There are two litters of lion cubs at play here. The younger ones, just 3 months in this world. Their bigger playmates, twice that time. Even though it's all fun and games at this stage, lion cubs face a tough fight to reach full size. Normally, only one out of every five cubs survives, with attacks from other lions, hyenas, and disease taking a huge toll. This evening, though, they frolic without an apparent care in the world. Then the attention of one turns to his father, one of two territorial males in this pride. Weighing in at just over 200 kilograms, this male all but ignores the playful assault, preferring to reserve his energy for the evening. Mother is also disturbed, all four of her teats being taken up for a sunset snack. There's much maneuvering to get a drink. Such feeding will last for only a few more weeks when they'll be weaned. As darkness falls, the pride stirs. Ahead of them tonight, their first taste of red meat. It's been 2 days since the adults have eaten, and there's almost certain to be a kill. As darkness sets in, they're on the move. Within an hour, they spot their quarry. This pride is known to have developed a skill in tracking and bringing down fully grown adult giraffes. Their victim breaks into a futile run. But the lions work quickly and efficiently to bring it down. Before the hyenas and vultures move in, the lions will devour as much of the carcass as they can. Theirs is a voracious appetite, a hungry male capable of consuming 30 kilograms of meat at the first feeding. Eventually, the cubs are left some smaller bones. It's a true feast, as they'll consume up to a quarter of their own body weight in just one meal. By first light, most of the pride are satiated, but not this six-month-old cub, who continues to feast well into the new day. For the remainder of the pride, it's time to slake their thirst at a nearby waterhole. King of beasts they may be, but even the lion is under threat from man. Less than 2 centuries ago, lions roamed freely across most of Africa and parts of southern Asia. Today, their habitat has shrunk substantially to central and southern Africa, with their future existence threatened in all but large officially protected areas. All of these losses are attributable to man, who's been intent on either killing them directly or through the elimination of open grass and shrub as wilderness became towns and farmland. Lions, it would seem, are losing their peace in many ways. From a rocky outcrop overlooking the Serengeti, these lions preen in the midday heat. A solitary male stalks below. Directly above this pride, a troop of olive baboons are intent on reclaiming what they consider to be their territory. A solitary female lion has taken over the very top of this rocky outcrop, known as a koppie. The baboons approach one by one to investigate. Even the baby baboons approach without apparent fear. Eventually, all of the baboons assemble within striking reach. At first, both sides hold their ground. Even though this baboon family usually eat grass and roots, they are known to have hunted and killed young antelope, armed as they are with teeth up to 5 centimeters long. But taking on a lion is a very different proposition. Occasionally the baboons recoil as the lion strikes out. But the baboons are not daunted. With military precision, they surround the lion from all sides, goading and taunting it. There are even moments of all-out retreat. But it's the lion who begins to exhibit increasing agitation. Finally, this lioness simply gives up her throne. Victory this day goes to the smaller but more persistent baboons. This evening for two of the lions is to reproduce. The prelude is this roaring, the male and female synchronizing their roars. There's plenty of interaction beforehand, the female acting as though she's not interested. Then, the moment of copulation. Very brief, usually around 6 seconds. It's an act which occurs repeatedly while the female is on heat, which usually lasts for up to a week. The female often acts aggressively, breaking away from the male, even attacking him. The result of this mating is a pregnancy lasting around 4 months, out of which we can expect to see between 2 and 4 cubs. The demise of the African elephant, the largest animal to walk the earth since prehistoric times, may be well documented, but here is the reality. These babies, frolicking in the waters of Botswana's wildlife-rich Okavango Delta, are all orphans, their parents slaughtered. Once they roamed most of Africa, their range has shrunk dramatically, with half their numbers killed in the 1980s. At that rate, poachers would have wiped out the elephant by the turn of the century. But thanks to rigorous anti-poaching measures and an international ban on ivory, numbers appear to have stabilized to around 600,000. Playful as these youngsters are, they'd been reared, as are all elephants, in a tight-knit community and would have been devastated by their parents' death. They're known to be highly intelligent creatures, speaking a complex language with which they can communicate over great distances. Juveniles possess many human-like qualities, such as strength and dignity, compassion and loyalty, and their play here today will be reinforcing their social bonds. As we watch these gregarious creatures interact, it's comforting to consider that the loss of the elephant, which would have been a great human tragedy, at last appears to have been averted. another of Africa's big five, is the Cape buffalo. While big herds still roam much of Central Africa, trophy hunters pose an ongoing threat, shooting thousands each year. And what an easy target, with the buffaloes preferring to move slowly in herds of 100 or more. They're usually found near rivers and waterholes, especially in the dry season. Buffaloes need to drink regularly and are especially fond of wallowing. Weighing in at 800 kilograms, their only predator is the lion. But they do play host to many other, much smaller creatures. While hunters like to bag them for their distinctive horns, the buffalo itself poses its own threat, carrying the tag of most dangerous of all African animals to humans, a reputation seemingly at odds from their frisky rituals this day. Of all the big cats, the leopard is undoubtedly the most graceful and agile. This young male is typical of their solitary nature, traveling and hunting alone, and only associating with a female just long enough to mate. In the heat of the day, he keeps a low profile, walking short distances before resting. The fact that he's walking at all by day is most unusual, with leopards normally nocturnal. Of all the carnivores, the leopard is by far the best survivor, occupying habitat as varied as deserts to dense forests. But like so many other African animals, the leopard's very existence is threatened by shrinking habitats, with numbers severely diminished. It's scrubland where they thrive, territory where water and game is plentiful. This leopard drinks for several minutes just before sunset, replenishing his energy before the evening's hunt. It's only then that he makes his move. He hunts by stealth, stalking carefully through the undergrowth. They are master hunters, these leopards, using the thick bush to creep up on prey. Catching sight of the leopard, a group of vervet monkeys sounds the alarm. Once night falls, the leopard lives out his reputation as the Prince of Stealth, stalking with infinite patience and complete silence. Such tactics pay off this evening as he kills a grey duiker, a small antelope. Having asphyxiated the duiker by biting its throat, the leopard hauls his catch up a tree. Here, it's safe from other predators, like the hyenas who patrol below, feasting on fallen scraps. Once he's secured his kill against the hyenas, this leopard is content to work the duiker very slowly, first patiently plucking its skin. The meal proper takes several hours. Only after consuming most of the duiker will the leopard rest. He'll sleep for the rest of the night, with his head on the catch to prevent it falling. The body of this freshly killed warthog demonstrates just how shy leopards are. Jackals have appeared, frightening off an extremely reclusive leopard who had just killed this warthog. These are black-backed jackals, well known as scavengers, yet still very cautious when approaching this warthog, as the leopard may still be close by. Jackals like these are monogamous and mainly travel in pairs, one of the few types of mammals to mate for life. They share every activity, from hunting and eating to defending territory. While his mate stands guard, the male jackal summons enough courage to move in. Even then, he takes one very tentative mouthful at a time. Other predators are nearby, his biggest concern being another jackal couple, their bitter rivals. When the other pair does approach, the first couple work together to scare them off. But not only are there other jackals to contend with, two hyenas are on the prowl. The hyenas stand off at a distance, eager to scavenge themselves. This day, there'll be no confrontation. The jackals are quickly satiated, leaving the hyenas the bulk of the warthog on which to feast. group of hunters that is seriously endangered is the African wild dog, or Cape hunting dog. Persecution and disease have decimated their numbers, with genuine fears they could soon be extinct. Only 3,000 remain across Africa, with several breeding programs now underway. These wild dogs live and play in packs, but they're also highly successful killers, using speed and endurance to bring down their quarry. They've been known to chase prey for more than 5 kilometers in as many minutes. Sunset at this hippopotamus pool in Zimbabwe's Hwange National Park is a scene of tranquility. But their species is enjoying anything but peace. Across Africa, their present distribution is but a fraction of its original range. And in very recent times, hippos have disappeared from about a third of all waterholes. Weighing up to 3,000 kilograms, they're the largest land animal in the world after the elephant, and clearly make an impression when they decide to move. Hippos are very aggressive, opening their huge jaws to assert themselves. This is formidable weaponry. Their tusks, made of ivory, are both exceptionally long and sharp. Mostly these displays are all that's needed to avert a fight, although they are a big killer of humans and animals that get in their way. While hippos normally spend their day in the water, occasionally they will emerge to graze, consuming up to 60 kilograms of vegetation at a time. But their bodies quickly overheat, and it's back into the environment in which they thrive. Here they'll spend most of the day lazing, almost totally submerged. Theirs is a very social species, with up to 30 members in each group. One peculiarity is their short, vertically flattened tail, which it uses to propel its dung a meter away, a ritual of great importance in this strictly hierarchical society. Just before submerging, their nostrils close, and when they've had enough of the world above, they simply sink below to spend up to 5 minutes in total peace. It's been compared to Noah's Ark, the volcanic crater in eastern Africa known as Ngorongoro. just about every major African animal and bird can be found in this 20 kilometer wide basin. And yet, its most precious tenant has almost been wiped out. Nowhere is the decimation of the black rhino by poachers more evident than in Ngorongoro. 4 decades ago, more than 100 rhinos ran wild here. Today, this mother and baby are one of the last couples left. Across Africa, the slaughter has been merciless. In the normal lifespan of just one black rhino, 62,000 of his kind have been killed. From 65,000 black rhinos in the 1960s, numbers have been shot and slaughtered by the thousands and thousands. Today, just 3,000 remain. Much is being done to try and save them. Anti-poaching squads and relocation to safer areas here in the Kruger National Park have slowed the rate of slaughter. Even the white rhino faces an uncertain future. Their population is estimated at 4,500 and is one of the great conservation success stories. That's due to breeding programs, like here in South Africa's Umfolozi Game Reserve, where this mother is sporting a mammoth horn more than a meter long. Just as unusual is the fact her baby is still suckling at the age of 4. Most babies stop suckling at only 12 months. Further south, at Pinda, rangers have sawn off the horn of this adult black rhino in a bid to deter poachers. But as she and her baby graze into the night, many highly respected wildlife experts believe that, in the long term, rhinos have a dark future, that they cannot be saved from extinction in the wild. They cite Africa's human population explosion, and with it, the demand for land. But large wild mammals like rhinos simply need lots of space. The two forces appear irreconcilable. There are numerous other species that are becoming increasingly hard to find across their former habitat in Africa. The aardwolf, a burrow dweller by day, who's known to consume up to 1 kilogram of termites at night. The serval cat, only a meter long, and yet possessing the longest legs, relatively, to all the cats. The cheetah, undeniably cute as babies, even when exhibiting the killer instincts they'll need to survive in later years. Where once they roamed most of Africa, their numbers are down to only 5,000, with only 40 remaining of one of their kind, the king cheetah. Sightings in the wild are extremely rare. So timid are they, they're known to hide in trees. As for the difference to a normal cheetah, it's all in the markings. 3 prominent black stripes on the back. Cheetahs on the hunt employ many different strategies to make a kill. This cat has spotted a herd of Thompson's gazelles grazing on a distant ridge in the northern Serengeti. At first, she covers the early distance between them simply by walking, stopping frequently to make sure she's not seen. But as if to camouflage her intentions, she sets up diversionary tactics, such as rolling in the grass, giving no hint that she's hungry or in a hurry. Over the course of an hour, she advances slowly, pausing in a creek bed for a drink. As the gazelle grazes innocently, she uses the cover of the long grass to make her final approach. Meters out, she makes her run. What speed? 112 kilometers an hour. But she's only able to sustain that pace for a few hundred meters before her rising temperature and a shortage of oxygen will force her to quit. As soon as she knocks the gazelle over, she lunges for its throat, securing a vice-like grip on its windpipe to choke it to death. This process lasts up to 5 minutes. All the time, she's on the alert for other predators, such as hyenas, who are anxious to take over her victory. At first, she tries to move her prize to a more secure spot. But with competition aplenty, she finally decides to eat in the open. The feast begins with the softer organs at the rear of the gazelle. Throughout her meal, she pauses nervously to check for other animals. Despite her ferocious appearance, cheetahs will not usually challenge other predators and is easily chased from her kill. Over the next hour, she consumes some 14 kilograms of meat, a meal that will satisfy her appetite for the next 5 days. Further south, in Natal, a young cheetah is fitted with a radio collar to allow researchers to monitor his behavior. A female is on heat nearby. The scientists are keen to observe the interaction. At first, the male stops frequently to mark his territory. The female, meanwhile, solicits him with a series of cries. But rather than tackle her alone, the first male teams up with a second. Male cheetahs are known to need the company of a second male to get excited enough in order to mate. Then, as if on a hunt, they stalk, then charge her at high speed. She remains submissive as both males reach her together. It's a ritual which will be played out throughout the day, ahead of mating that night. Many of the cubs that result from such mating are hand-raised, like these two being reared in a curator's home in Oudtshoorn, South Africa. It's a valiant gesture by man to save the species his forebears have almost completely wiped out. These cubs are part of a captive breeding program, which sees fully grown cheetahs reintroduced to the wild. It's a heartening development, one that's being tried with an increasing number of other endangered animals. Only through such tactics can man hope to save still more of Africa's superb creatures from disappearing forever.